You ready for the word? All right. All right. I love this. So, a few weeks back, started talking about some things from the Gospel of Mark. You know, Thursday night, we're going to switch topics. And we're looking for a new book of the Bible to kind of go into on Thursdays, and we'll stay there for months. And so God really directed me to the Gospel of Mark, and began to read Mark with fresh eyes, with fresh hunger, looking for things I hadn't really seen before, and, for God to speak to me through that book. And immediately he began to do that, of course. It's wonderful. And so one of the things God showed me, We began to talk about the kingdom, right, several weeks back, about how the beginning of the gospel opened up with the announcement of the kingdom of God. And talked about that a little bit, kind of introduced the topic, and talked about why the Holy Spirit came in the form of a dove, also in the beginning of the gospels. If you missed that, get the CD, really. And then the Lord kind of, just whispered to me a little bit back the title, four top things that Jesus taught his disciples, And when he kind of gave me that title, I wasn't even sure what the top four things were. I know the Bible pretty well. I probably could have figured it out, but I'm like, okay, God, what are you talking about here? And the significance of this is one of the main things that Jesus did when he was here, there were several huge, huge things that he did, but one of the main things he was doing was training disciples, right? Investing himself in this period of three and a half years into these disciples. Because why? After Jesus goes back to heaven, when it's all over, guess what? If he doesn't have trained, equipped disciples that are absolutely committed to this thing, the church dies, right? The kingdom dies right there. It doesn't move on. And so it was a huge, huge priority to get some guys that were, and this is what we talked about last week. One of the things that Jesus taught his disciples throughout his whole time on earth was commitment, right? And again, I don't like that word so much. I couldn't find a better word. But what Jesus was actually telling them is basically salvation costs you nothing, right? But being a disciple costs you everything. Amen? Salvation is what Jesus paid for on the cross. Call on the name of Jesus and be saved. Amen? Believe in the Lord and be saved. But he repeatedly talked about being a disciple, and he said, take up your cross and follow me. That means you're going to die, right? It's going to cost you your life. And he said, sell everything. He said, basically, in many, many different ways, Jesus said, this is going to cost you everything. And agree in advance. If you're going to be a disciple, it'll cost you everything, including your life, And so he needed people that had that absolute commitment that when and if it cost them their life, they were ready, that they were going to live for him. And that's how the church was birthed in the earth and continued in the earth. If not for that, it wouldn't work. And then there were some other things that Jesus taught his disciples. We're going to talk about them over the coming weeks. But think about that. If Jesus, one of his main purpose was to make disciples, and there was about four main themes that he kept teaching them over and over, he'd go back to these themes again and again and again. Shouldn't we know what they are? Amen. If we're disciples today, right, we got to know this is important stuff. This is a big deal. So the first one was salvation costs you nothing, but discipleship costs you everything. Ha. And the second thing here is that he really began to teach them about is the kingdom. We introduced it a few weeks ago, but I want to go into more detail today. So let's look, first of all, though, just by way of kind of reminder, maybe, look at Mark chapter 1, verse 8. I'm excited about this. I'm repeating this point over and over for the past few weeks because I want it really to get deep inside of your heart. Every gospel, Matthew, Mark, Luke, and John, opens with this announcement from John the Baptist in one form or another, and he says, I indeed baptized you with water, but he, Jesus, when he comes, he will baptize you with the Holy Spirit, right? And again, it's one of the ways that helps to understand what he's saying is to think about what he's not saying. Again, he's not saying he's coming to bring a new religion. He didn't say that at all, did he? He's coming to show you the way to heaven. He didn't even say that. He said he's coming to baptize you with the Holy Spirit. Right? That's the opening statement of the Gospels, for you to be filled with the Spirit of God in a supernatural way and live in a partnership with the Spirit of God for the rest of your life as a member of the kingdom, right? Amazing thing, amazing thing. Does he show us how to get to heaven? Well, yeah. Remember, salvation costs us nothing. It cost him everything. But he came to baptize you with the Holy Spirit. And then, moving on in verse 14 and 15, I think it is. Yeah, it says, there's another thing that all the Gospels open with, this. It says, after John was put in prison, Jesus came to Galilee, preaching the gospel of the kingdom of God, and 15, and saying, the time is fulfilled and the kingdom of God is at hand. Repent and believe in the gospel. And so he's opening with this announcement that the kingdom of God is here. It's invading right now. It's coming onto the scene. And again, think about what he didn't say. Here's a new religion. Here's the way to heaven. No, he said, the kingdom of God. Here it is. Deal with it. Respond to it. Choose sides. Choose allegiances, right? Come into agreement with it or fight against it. Be hot or cold, but here it is. Boom, right? It's a kingdom, and he wants you to be filled with the Holy Spirit. So that's how the thing opens. And then if you jump all the way up to the book of Acts chapter 1, read verse 1, start there anyway. And so this is after Jesus does his ministry, trains the disciples, dies on the cross, rises from the dead, right? And now Luke is writing this, and he says, the former account I made, O Theophilus, of all that Jesus began both to do and teach until the day in which he was taken up, after he, through the Holy Spirit, had given commandments to the apostles whom he had chosen, to whom he also presented himself alive after his suffering by many infallible proofs. Here's what I was headed for. Being seen by them for how long again? 40 days after the resurrection, he continues to appear to the disciples, and he no longer uses doors and things like that. And he doesn't show up in a taxi, he just appears. Boom, here he is. And for 40 days, he's appearing to them. And what's he talking about? Speaking of the things pertaining to the kingdom of God. Wow. So he opened with that message, the kingdom of God is at hand. And then after the resurrection, after he rises from the dead, for 40 days he's talking to his disciples about the kingdom, the kingdom, the kingdom. Wow, because the kingdom had come into a new phase at that point, right? The kingdom was coming in steps or stages. The first stage of the kingdom was when Jesus was here personally. Jesus was the kingdom. He's the king and the kingdom all at once, right? Everywhere Jesus was, the kingdom was. And sickness fell, and sin fell, and demons are cast out, and everywhere Jesus goes, the kingdom is manifested and demonstrated, and everything the devil done falls before him, right? Jesus is the kingdom. After he dies on the cross, rises from the dead, now he says what? I will come and live in you, right? I'll be in you and you in me. And then where's the kingdom now? The kingdom is now in each of us, right? And the kingdom is expanded into a new phase. And that's what kind of we'll talk about more today. And then, so we're still in that phase of the kingdom, spreading the kingdom. It's a spiritual kingdom, person by person, right? And the kingdom lives inside of you. And then there's another phase of the kingdom coming when Jesus will physically come back from heaven. His feet will touch down on the earth, right? And it says he will destroy all wickedness, all sin, all injustice, every kind of evil in the earth. He'll literally judge it, destroy it, wipe it out, set up a kingdom, put a throne in Jerusalem, and he will literally physically reign over the earth, and we will reign and rule with him, right? And then even that's not the final stage. Later on, it says he destroys heaven and earth, burns it up, makes a new heaven and a new earth, and then we reign forever with Jesus. And I don't even know what that looks like. That just melts my brain. Right, so, but he's talking, the whole thing is about the kingdom, isn't it? The kingdom message didn't go away after the resurrection. He's talking to them for 40 days about the kingdom, the kingdom, the kingdom. Here it is now. And you guys are part of it, ready to go. So look at Acts 8, verse 4. Jumped up there. So in the early church, what were they preaching? Kingdom, kingdom, right? It says in Acts chapter 8, therefore those who were scattered went everywhere preaching the word. There was a persecution in Jerusalem there in that area, and they're scattered away. And Philip went down to the city of Samaria and preached Christ to them. And the multitudes with one accord heeded the things spoken by Philip, hearing and seeing the miracles which he did. And unclean spirits crying with a loud voice came out of many who were possessed, and many who were paralyzed and lame were healed. And there's great joy in the city. And then you jump up to verse, which one is it? 12. And it says, when they believed Philip as he preached the things concerned, what was he preaching? The kingdom of God and the name of Jesus Christ. Both men and women were baptized. So the kingdom message goes on. That's what they were preaching in the early church in the book of Acts, preaching the kingdom, but they're preaching the gospel. Now, in the beginning of the gospels, remember Jesus said, it said Jesus was preaching the gospel of the kingdom. Believe the gospel. That gospel wasn't that Jesus died and rose. Yeah, that gospel was, here comes the kingdom, right? And it's good news. After Jesus died and rose, he said to his disciples, go into all the world and preach the gospel, right? Which now is the message of his death for us and his resurrection, right? And believe in him and be saved. That's the gospel. But did the kingdom message go away? No, the gospel is the entrance to the kingdom, right? What Jesus did on the cross and the resurrection is our entrance into the kingdom and our right to operate in the kingdom. And so what is Philip preaching? The kingdom of God and the name of Jesus Christ, how to enter the kingdom, how to operate in the kingdom, how to be authorized and empowered in the kingdom through Jesus Christ, right? And that's the message that he was giving to the early church. And then if you jump all the way to the end of the book of Acts, chapter 28, it's verse 30 and 31. These are the last two verses in the book of Acts. And this is about Paul, the Apostle Paul, later on in his ministry when he ended up in Rome. And it said, Paul dwelt 2 whole years in his own rented house and received all who came to him. And here's the last verse of the book of Acts. What was he doing? Preaching the kingdom of God. And teaching the things which concern the Lord Jesus Christ with all confidence, no one forbidding him. Paul, the apostle, did he know what he's talking about? He wrote, what, half the New Testament, right? He basically laid down the doctrine, really, for what we believe, right? By revelation, he was able to do that. And he's preaching the kingdom of God and the Lord Jesus Christ. Again, same thing Philip was doing, right? And so, wow, this must be important, huh? Apparently, right? So if we don't understand the kingdom, we're kind of missing one of the main things that Jesus was teaching his disciples, that this is a kingdom, not a religion, not just a church. It's a kingdom. Amen? All right. Well, let's look at Luke chapter 13, starting verse 18 through 21. There's a kind of a point I want to make here. We know that Jesus was teaching in parables, right? One of the main things that Jesus did over and over was he was teaching in what we call parables, little stories that have symbolic meaning. Okay, and I've read through all of those parables, of course, studied them all, you know, many times, and find that basically all of those parables deal with one theme for the most part. And you know what the theme is? The kingdom. Yeah, and so, and I'm just going to read Luke 13 here, these few verses, because this is one of the places where it's so obvious and clear what Jesus is doing. So he said to them, what is the kingdom of God like, and to what shall I compare it? What's he doing? He's saying here, I'm calling you guys, he's teaching his disciples, right? He's saying, I'm calling you guys into something, and I've got to teach you some things that I really want you to get, really want you to understand. Before I go back to heaven, here's what I've got to deposit into you. You've got to know this stuff. You've got to understand what this is about. So I'm going to teach you about the kingdom of God. How can I describe it to you? How can I help you understand it? So he teaches it in parables. And go ahead, verse 19. Through 21, here's just a couple of really super short ones. He said, the kingdom of God is like a mustard seed, which a man took and put in his garden. And it grew and became a large tree, and the birds of the air nested in its branches. Wow, what are you saying, Jesus? Is the kingdom of God, what's it like? The key words here, you just look for the main thought. What's the main thought he's trying to get across? It's something very, very small. Mustard seeds are known for being incredibly small, right? Very, very small, seemingly so insignificant, almost unnoticeable, that a mustard seed would be planted. But then what does it become? Notice the word, a large tree. It's small and it becomes large. And it's a seed that's deposited and it grows and it becomes, here in this case, he describes a large tree and the birds of the air nest in its branches. I believe what he's saying is that the kingdom of God comes into your heart, right? And it grows and then it becomes a large tree. And when you first received the gospel, it might have seemed like a pretty insignificant thing, right? But after 10 years, 20 years, 30 years, and now you've become this person that's ministering to people all around you. You're like the tree, and the birds of the air come to you for food and come to you for shelter and come to you. You're ministering to people all around you. You've become this tree of the kingdom, right? And it started with one tiny little seed. And so that's what Jesus is telling. I want you to understand the kingdom. Let's give it to you in symbols. Go ahead, 20. And again, he said to them, what shall we liken, or to what shall I liken the kingdom of God? Let me put it to you another way. Verse 21, it is like leaven, which a woman took and hid in three measures of meal, till it was all leavened. Right? Well, we know that in the Old Testament, at least in one spot, the leaven was used as a symbol of sin, right? But here he's not using it that way. If you look at the context here, he's clearly not using it that way. He says leaven is actually like yeast, right? It's a living, one-celled organism that you put in dough when you're making bread, and right, and then it multiplies inside the bread, feeds on the sugars of the bread, and it gives off gases, and it fills the whole bread, and the bread rises, and that's how you make bread. And so he says, he's using the word leaven here, or yeast, as a symbol of influence. He said the kingdom of God works like influence. You put a little bit into the dough, or into the meal, he says here, and then it grows and it multiplies, and it transforms everything around it. Until it's all transformed. That's what the kingdom of God is like. Right? So when that seed of the kingdom of God comes into your heart, what does it do inside of you, first of all? Multiplies, grows inside of you, and transforms you from the inside out. And then as the kingdom of God, and these, you can apply these on many, many levels. It transforms you and me, but then it also, we also are the leaven, right, of the kingdom of God. Anywhere we go, we begin to influence the world around us, right? And so the kingdom of God is always about influence and expanding and multiplying. And he said, that's how the kingdom works. All right. Well, I just wanted you to read those for a few verses because I wanted you to really get the point. Virtually all the parables deal with the kingdom of God, explaining the kingdom of God some way. And there's a number of things that Jesus wanted us to really get. I started in this message last night for the Saturday night group, and I actually thought I was going to get through all my notes. I got through half of my notes, so we won't finish this one today even. but there's some things that Jesus really wanted us to get about the kingdom. So let me give you a few of those things. Luke chapter 10, verse 25, goes all the way to 37. Here's the first one. And we'll read through the story, and then I'll tell you one of the main points that he wanted us to get here. So it says, behold, a certain lawyer stood up and tested Jesus. And this is not a lawyer the way we understand a lawyer. This is an expert in Jewish law, Mosaic law. And he said, he's testing Jesus, and he says, teacher, what shall I do to inherit eternal life? Okay. And Jesus said to him, what is written in the law? What is your reading of it? Well, that's an interesting answer. It's an interesting question. He's an expert in the Jewish law. Doesn't he know the answer? Yeah, but he's testing him, isn't he? His motive is, I'm trying to trap you. I'm trying to get you, right, trapped somehow, because I don't believe in you. And so Jesus said, well, what does the law say? So the man answered and said, you shall love the Lord your God with all your heart, all your soul, with all your strength, and with all your mind, and love your neighbor as yourself. Okay, well, I don't know about you, but when I read that one, I go, okay, is there a plan B? Because I've already blown that one. I've already failed that one, and I can't even say that I made it through any 24-hour period of my life passing both of those things. How about you? Really? So, is that really the right answer? Is that how you inherit eternal life? Love God with all your heart, love your neighbors yourself. If you do that, you get eternal life. That's what Jesus presented back to him as the answer. That's what the Mosaic law says. Why is Jesus putting that in his face? Because the man's trying to trap him. And he's an expert in the law himself. And what's, again, does the law have the power to save you? It doesn't. It absolutely doesn't. All the law does is expose our desperate, desperate need for a savior. If you look at the laws and you say, wow, I've failed. Yeah, check, 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 check. Oh, I did okay at that one. Oop, next check. You know, I failed. Right. I need a savior. I desperately need a savior. That's what the law is intended to do. Nothing else. Illustrate that you need a savior. And so he's throwing this back at the guy saying, do you think you need a savior? Right. And we talked about a verse similar to this last week. This is a different guy, though. This is a different one. And so he answers the man with the law. Go ahead. Verse 28. And the man said to him, or Jesus said to him, you've answered rightly. Do this and you'll live. Okay, so he says, yeah, if you follow these rules, you'll live, you'll make it, right? How are you doing at that? Okay? Do you need a savior, or are you doing okay yourself? Right? And now the man says, wanting to justify himself. What does it mean? Why is he wanting to justify himself? Because he already knows in his heart that he's failed. He already knows. So he's looking for some loopholes here. And he said, well, who is my neighbor? I don't have to love everybody, do I? I don't have to love the people that are, you know, do I? I don't have to love them. Just the good people, just the people like me, right? So go ahead. And Jesus answered and said, now Jesus is going to give a parable. And this parable is an answer to the man's question about who is my neighbor and who should I love. However, hidden in this parable is the message of the kingdom of God in an amazing way. You know, just a very cool thing. We'll read through it and then we'll go back. So Jesus answered and said to the man, a certain man went down from Jerusalem to Jericho and fell among thieves who stripped him of his clothing, wounded him and departed, leaving him half dead. And now by chance, a certain priest came down that road. And when he saw him, he passed by on the other side. Likewise, a Levite, when he arrived at the place, came and looked and passed by on the other side. And a certain Samaritan, as he journeyed, came where he was. And when he saw him, he had compassion. Now already, so he went to him and bandaged his wounds, pouring on oil and wine. And he set him on his own animal, brought him to an inn, and took care of him. And on the next day, when he departed, he took out 2 denarii and gave them to the innkeeper and said to him, take care of him. Whatever more you spend when I come again, I will repay you. All right? There's the parable. And so Jesus said, so which of these three do you think was the neighbor to him who fell among the thieves? And 37, the man said, he who showed mercy on him. And Jesus said, go and do likewise. So in answer to the man's question, who's my neighbor, who should I love, right? Jesus says, love everybody, right? And that's the answer. I get that. And that one's really, really interesting too, because Jesus used as the main character of the story, as the good guy in the story, a Samaritan. And this man is an expert in the Jewish law. And the Jewish people at that time in that place really didn't have good feelings for the Samaritans, right? The Samaritans are kind of a half-Jewish, half-Gentile group of people over here that that basically the Jews don't want nothing to do with them. They're like, you're dogs. You're inferior. We want, right? You just don't. We don't touch you. We don't get near you. And so Jesus uses the Samaritan as the good guy in the story. That's already kind of in your face and offensive to this Jewish expert, isn't he? It really is. And he said the Levite and the priest passed by and didn't help the guy, but the Samaritan helped him. That's pretty, you know. All right. So, but there's more to this story. Go back to, where did it begin? 30, was it 30? Or 31, 30? Okay, here we go. So in 30. Now, hidden in these parables is something that Jesus is teaching us about the kingdom, and it's an amazing thing. A certain man went down from Jerusalem to Jericho. The certain man is going to represent Adam. Let's say Adam and Eve, really, but Adam, right? The Bible talks about Adam. So as Adam went down, which direction did Adam go? Down, he fell. Adam and Eve fell from grace. He went down from Jerusalem to Jericho. He fell from God's will, from God's place into the world, right? Through sin and the fall. And he fell among thieves. Who's the thief? The thief only comes to steal, kill, and destroy. It's the devil, right? It's Satan. He fell among thieves who stripped him of his clothing, stripped him of his righteousness, wounded him, and departed, leaving him what? Half dead. How can you be half dead? Well, we know what he means in the right, beaten half to death. But what he's referring to here actually is what happened to Adam and Eve after they sinned. Physically alive, spiritually dead, half dead. Whew. 31. And now by chance a certain priest came down that road. When he saw him, he passed by on the other side. The priest saw him laying there wounded, bleeding, and said, ew. Cross over here, right? And then, go ahead. And 32 also says, and likewise a Levite, when he arrived at the place, came and looked and passed by on the other side. Ooh. And so what is he saying? What is Jesus saying here? That the priest and the Levite represent religion, and they represent the law specifically, the Mosaic law. And can the Mosaic law help you? Does the Mosaic law help you when you're half dead and wounded and broken? No. It said, here's the standard, you perform. But it can't help you. It can't rescue you. It doesn't even offer you love, honestly. You know, it's just here's the standard. And then what happens? A certain Samaritan as he journeyed. Now the Samaritan's going to represent Jesus. Very, very cool. And it says, a certain Samaritan as he journeyed came where he was. That's interesting. What did Jesus do? He came where we were. In our fallen state, in our brokenness, half dead, Jesus came to us. He didn't say, hey, here I am up here. Here's a standard. You perform and see if you can get up here. He said, I'll come down to you. I'll rescue you. He came where he was. And when he saw him, what did he have? Compassion. That's Jesus. That's God's heart for us. He had compassion on him. And 34. So he went with him. He went to him and bandaged his wounds, pouring on oil and wine. Oh, what does the oil always represent? Holy Spirit. What does the wine represent? The blood of Jesus. He comes to him, and by the cross and the shed blood, right, of Jesus for forgiveness, and then by the Holy Spirit coming to live in him, coming to live in us, right, and revive us, bring us back to life, and heal us. He pours in the oil and the wine, and he set him on his own animal, brought him to an inn, and took care of him. Where did Jesus bring us? Into the church, which is a place where people are supposed to be healed, amen, and taken care of. Hallelujah. Go ahead. And on the next day when he departed, he took out 2 denarii, gave them to the innkeeper, and said, take care of him, and whatever more you spend, when I come again, I'll repay you. Who's the innkeeper? The Holy Spirit, who's here with us right now on earth, leading and guiding the church, right? And this is the place where we're being taken care of, and we're being healed. And why did he, what did he pay him for his stay? He took out 2 denarii, and 1 denarius was 1 day's wage in that time and culture, 1 day's wage. So 2 denarius is 2 days wages. He paid in advance for 2 days, and a day with the Lord is like a 1,000 years. Paid in advance for 2,000 years. And he said, I'll be back. And he said, and if it takes a little bit longer, then I'll cover that too. But I'm planning to be back in about 2,000 years. Now, this is, Jesus hid the message of the whole kingdom in here, in the parable. It's an amazing thing. And one of the points that I wanted to make to you, one of the things that Jesus is trying to get us to understand about the kingdom here, very important, is that the kingdom here happens in kind of a parentheses. You know what parentheses are, right, in writing? Okay. The kingdom happens in a kind of parentheses, being the first parentheses is the first coming of Jesus, when he comes the first time, and then the kingdom comes into the earth, and then the second parentheses is when Jesus comes back from heaven, right? And during these two parentheses, the first coming and the second coming of Jesus, is what we call the church age. And it's also the introduction of the kingdom into the earth, right? And so in this time called the church age of 2,000 years was basically hidden in the Old Testament. Anybody ever heard the phrase, in the Old Testament concealed, in the New Testament revealed? Okay, yeah, that's a theological term, which means there was all kinds of amazing things in the Old Testament that were the prophecies are there, but they're in a form that you wouldn't really understand, you know, exactly how this is all going to play out. But it's all there. It's hidden, but it's hidden to be revealed. And when Jesus came, he began to reveal. There's this 2,000-year time that was unseen in the Old Testament, and it begins now. Right? And then I'll come back. Right? It's called the church age. Very, very interesting. Okay, yeah, go ahead. Look at Matthew 13, 24 to 30. Here's another parable that he put forth to them, saying, the kingdom of heaven, oh, what are we still talking about? Right? Kingdom of God, kingdom of heaven, is like a man who sowed good seed in his field. What? And here we have it. It's in veiled form right here. The man who sowed good seed in his field, it's the first coming of Jesus, because he comes the first time and he's sowing the word of the kingdom, right? He's sowing the word into the world. The first coming. Go ahead. But while men slept, his enemy came and sowed tares among the wheat and went his way. Now we have the introduction of another concept. Who's the enemy? Right? Satan. And he's coming and he's sowing some tares. Tares are a kind of a weed, an unwanted growth, but the tares look like wheat. They look like a wheat plant up until about the time that it starts maturing and bearing fruit. And then you can tell when it starts bearing fruit, it's not wheat. It's a weed. But it kind of disguises and it grows among the wheat. And it's a farmer's enemy, of course. And what's even worse about the tares is that the tares, they can even grow right so close to the wheat that they will intertwine their roots with the wheat's roots. And you can't tear up one without tearing out the other. And that's obviously going to mean something in this parable. So the enemy came and sowed tares among the wheat and went his way. And when the grain had sprouted and produced a crop, then the tares also appeared. And so the servants of the owner came and said to him, "Sir, did you not sow good seed in your field? How then does it have tares?" And he said to them, "An enemy has done this." And the servant said to him, "Do you want us then to go and gather them up?" But he said, "No, lest while you gather up the tares, you also uproot the wheat with them." You can't pull out one without damaging the other right now. "So let both grow together until the harvest. And at the time of harvest, I will say to the reapers, 'First gather together the tares and bind them in bundles to burn them, but gather the wheat into my barn.'" Wow, what's the parable that, again, it referenced here is the first coming when he sows the crop, right? He sows the seed, and then there's a time of when the seed grows and the plants grow, and then the harvest is being produced. So what is the kingdom age or the church age all about? Sowing the seed of the kingdom and then letting it bear fruit in the earth, right? All through, not just Israel now, but throughout all the nations of the world, right? Sowing that kingdom in and then letting the crop come forth. But in the end, it's referenced here, there's a second coming, and in the end, what they do is they'll come and separate the tares from the wheat, and one of them gets burned, but one of them gets preserved, the saved, right? Whew. Wow. And Jesus is introducing this idea to his disciples, because did his disciples know this before he's telling them these parables? They don't know this. They don't know that there's a 2,000-year time coming. It's called the church age, right? And what's going to happen during this time? They don't get that at all. Remember, that's why Jesus appeared to them after the resurrection for 40 days, teaching them about the kingdom of God. He's clarifying all these things to them. He's teaching them these things, right? Even with more clarity, so that they understand this. They've got to get this, right? Because they're bringing the kingdom into the world. Very interesting stuff. So what's really the purpose of this whole thing? It's getting this harvest, isn't it? It's getting this harvest of people coming to Jesus. Look at Mark chapter 4, verse 1. And it goes on for quite a while here. This is in Mark chapter 4. This is one of the places where Jesus really introduces these parables in a very intense way here, concentrated way. He introduces parables and he's teaching them about the kingdom, introducing the kingdom. So here it says again, Jesus began to teach by the sea, and a great multitude was gathered to him, so that he got into a boat and sat in it on the sea, and the whole multitude was on the land facing the sea. Sounds like a nice place to teach. And then he taught them many things in parables again. And he said to them in his teaching, "Listen, behold, a sower went out to sow." Now, you all heard this, right? If you've been a Christian for any length of time, you've heard this. You've been taught this, I'm sure. "It happened as he sowed that some seed fell by the wayside, and the birds of the air came and devoured it. And some fell on stony ground, where it did not have much earth. And immediately it sprang up, because it had no depth of earth. And when the sun was up, it was scorched, because it had no root, it withered away. And some seed fell among thorns, and the thorns grew up and choked it, and it yielded no crop. And other seed fell on good ground and yielded a crop that sprang up and increased and produced, some 30-fold, some 60, and some 100. So Jesus teaches us this parable, and he says, "Does everybody understand?" And they all go, "Uh-huh." No. No idea what you're talking about. But they remembered the story. Remember the story. Go ahead. And he said to them, "He who has ears to hear, let him hear. He who has spiritual ears, he who can listen with his heart," right? Try it. Get it. All right, go ahead. "And when he was alone, those around him with the 12 asked him about the parable." So this, after the crowd is gone, he's with his 12, and there's other disciples too, not just the 12. There's the group that really followed him closely. And they said, "Fill us in here. Come on, help us out here." because you can't blame them. We understand this because we understand the church age now, don't we? We're living at the end of it. We're living in the last minutes on God's clock of the church age. And Jesus is coming back sometime soon, probably within my lifetime, probably within our lifetime. And but we know this now. But at the time, did the disciples understand any of this? Absolutely not. Absolutely not. They're still wrapping their head around who Jesus is, right? And you know, this is all new, completely new stuff to them. And so they're like, fill us in, help us with this. What are you talking about? Go ahead. And he said to them, to you it has been, I love this. To you it has been given to know, what? The mystery of the kingdom of God. Is he talking to you and me now too? Yeah. Yeah, but to those who are outside, all things come in parables. Oh, I love this. I love this. You and I are given the privilege of knowing the mystery of the kingdom of God. Whew. One of the things that we just mentioned a minute ago was this idea that there's this time in, you know, in between parentheses, the first coming of Jesus, the second coming of Jesus, sowing the kingdom into the world, and then the harvest time and everything that happens in between, right? That's a mystery that we understand in the church, but the people of the world, do they understand that? No, they make fun of it. They don't believe it. Stupid Christians, right? But we understand what's going on. Is Jesus really going to come back? Yeah, absolutely, right? And then they go, oh, right? Yeah, we know the mystery of the kingdom of God. And Jesus is teaching us personally, right? But to those who are outside, they come in parables. What are parables again? Stories that are symbolic. And what's the point of parables? If you want to understand, you can. If you don't want to understand, you don't have to. You can make fun of it, you can mock it, you can walk away and say, that didn't mean anything. But if you're a person who's hungry for God, you can say, oh, there's the mystery revealed right there. Go ahead. And verse 12, so that seeing they may see and not perceive, and hearing they may hear and not understand, lest they should turn and their sins be forgiven them. That sounds like a very harsh thing. I'm teaching in parables so they won't understand. Doesn't Jesus want everybody to be saved? Yes, but only if they have a heart that will humbly come and say, I humble myself and I need a Savior. I need a Savior. But the people who are proud, think they got it all together, people that love evil, whatever else disqualifies them, says, you're not going to see this. You're not going to see this. You're blind to it. But when you humble your heart and you know you need a Savior, it opens up to you. Go ahead. And verse 13, he said to them, do you not understand this parable? How then will you understand all the parables? Meaning, apparently, that this parable, he's introducing again the idea that the parables talk about what? The kingdom. So if you get the fact that all these parables are keys to the kingdom, so then you'll understand. And that this parable apparently has some symbols that other parables have in common, right? So verse 14, the sower sows the word. Now, I'm not going to read through the whole thing because you've had teaching on this. I'm sure most of you, probably all of you, had teaching on this. But the short version is what the sower sows the word. So the first coming of Jesus, he sows the word, right? And what is the seed in the parable? The word of God, right? Why does he use seed as a symbol for the word of God? Seed is alive, and seed has the ability to reproduce what it came from. Right? The word of God came from God's heart. It came from heaven into this world. It's sowing into this world the kingdom of heaven and God's very heart and God's very presence and nature. And wherever that seed goes, it'll grow and reproduce where it came from. Huh, how cool is that? Right? And so this is a supernatural thing. The word of God is amazing. It's an amazing thing. So if the seed reproduces the kingdom, don't we want to preach the word of God like a lot? Understand it, preach it, teach it a lot. Sow that seed, because wherever you sow the seed, the kingdom will grow. Amen? Whew. And where does he sow the seed? He's talking about into different kinds of soil, and obviously he's talking about our hearts, isn't he? So he's talking about the condition of our heart. The seed goes into your heart, and he says, some of the seed fell on the wayside, and the birds came and ate it up. What's that? It's like falling on the sidewalk. You know, it can't penetrate. It's hard ground, and it can't penetrate, and a bird comes and eats it, and it's over. And he said, that's Satan. Satan comes, if your heart is hard when you hear the word, it doesn't penetrate, and Satan comes and takes it away, and you forget that you even heard it. Anything wrong with the seed? Not a thing. The seed was good, just the soil wasn't wasn't receptive. And then he said the seed can fall on stony ground, right? Where there's a little bit of dirt, but there's stones and rocks. What is a stony ground? That's when we're hard-hearted and we have resentment and bitterness and self-will and stubbornness and things. But we still have a place, we still receive the gospel, but it has a hard time putting down roots in us. It has a hard time really getting established and growing and producing fruit, because the rocks are unforgiveness and our bitterness and our anger and our stubbornness and our whatever, right? Those are blocking the growth of the word in our heart. That's what Jesus is teaching. And then there was seed that fell among thorns, right, and weeds. And it says, as the seed is growing, the weeds and the thorns are trying to choke it out. And he said, that's the cares of this world, the things of this world. So, you know, the devil's dangling in front of you. Go after this. Go after fame. Go after pleasure. Go after fortune. Go after, you know, whatever it is. And, you know, pleasures of this world. And if you go after everything that's dangled in front of you by the world, right, then it'll choke out the seed of the word, right? But he said, but if the seed falls on good ground, where somebody values the word of God and says, oh, this word is bringing life and transformation and revolution and power. This word is amazing and supernatural and it's growing inside of me. I receive this. I value this. I dedicate myself to this. That word will reproduce the kingdom of God in you and through you. And he said, some 30, some 60, some 100-fold. 100 times what you received is what you'll produce. And he's not capping it there. He's just throwing out numbers to give you the idea, right? You can produce a little, you can produce a lot. You can produce 1,000-fold, 1,000,000-fold, right? This is an amazing thing. Jump to verse 21. So, now Jesus says to them, and he's continuing in parables, is a lamp brought to be put under a basket or under a bed? Is it not to be set on a lampstand? Okay, now he's talking about, we're not talking about farming anymore, now we're talking about bedroom furniture. Okay, now what are you saying, Jesus? All right. What's the lamp? The word of God. It's the word of God again that is introduced in the world, because a lamp brings light, right? And so do you put a lamp under a bed where nobody can see the light? No, it's meant to be shined out in the open, right? So go ahead. He's talking about the word again. For there is nothing hidden which will not be revealed. Ooh, I love this. Some of you know this one very well. Nor has anything been kept secret, but that it should come to light. Oh, let's talk about that. Nothing hidden which will not be revealed. What's he talking about? Are there things hidden in the Bible? Absolutely. Yeah. Remember, we were just talking about it a minute ago. That whole 2,000-year window of the church from the first coming of Jesus to the second coming of Jesus. If you, as an Old Testament, Old Covenant Jew, had read all the prophecies, you know, and studied them all, would you ever have figured that out in the natural? No. But it was there. In the Old Testament, it's all there, but you'd have never figured it out until it was revealed to you. God hid things in the Bible so that they could be revealed later on. And revealed to who? People who are hungry, humble, and know they need a Savior, right? People who value the Word of God. And so everything in here, it's, Marcy said it one time, it's like a game of hide and seek. God doesn't hide things from us, He hides things for us. When you play a game with the kids, right? When you play Easter eggs with kids, do you hide them in really, really, really hard places? No, you hide them, you know, with the little blue egg sticking out, so the kid goes, oh, I found it! Yeah, and you're like, yay, good for you, all right. Like, you hid it for them, not from them, right? Okay, and that's what God does in the Bible. He hides things for us, not from us. And we discover it. Look what I saw in the Bible, look at this revelation I got. And he goes, it's like the little blue Easter egg sticking out there, you know? You know? But everybody else missed it. But the person who's hungry for God sees it. And all of this is meant to be revealed. Everything that God put in the Bible is meant to be revealed throughout the church age, fully understood, fully lived, and fully practiced before Jesus comes back. Amen? And that's why God's been restoring things in the church. You know, after the early church, get off subject here, but in the early church, you know, from the book of Acts, a lot of stuff got lost, didn't it? I mean, the whole thing of apostles and prophets got lost, and evangelists got lost, and teachers got lost, and they sort of held on to pastors for a long time. The gospel itself, the purity of the gospel was lost, and it was all religion and works and craziness, right? And then really God started restoring things seriously about 500 years ago with Martin Luther restoring the purity of the gospel, you know, that you're actually saved by grace through faith, not by works. And then they restored water baptism to immersion, and then they restored, God restored, the baptism of the Holy Spirit, people getting filled with the Holy Spirit, speaking in tongues, laying hands on the sick, and people getting healed, and right, restoring the gifts of the Spirit, and people are prophesying again, and miracles are happening. And then he restores God's been restoring, even in my lifetime, the prophets and the apostles, and he's been restoring all this stuff, and it's all meant to be revealed, lived, and fully experienced before Jesus comes back. Everything in here. Amen? Everything in here. And so it's a treasure book here. It's a treasure trove that if you open it up and begin to search it out, there's amazing treasures there hidden for you. Not from you. Nor has anything been kept secret that but should come to light. And that's what Jesus was doing, even in the parable of the Good Samaritan. It's all here. You'll see it. Right. Go ahead. We get it. 23. If anyone has, he said it again, ears to hear, let him hear. Okay. Then he said to them, take heed what you hear. With the same measure that you use, it'll be measured to you. And to you who hear, more will be given. And 25. For whoever has, to him more will be given. Whoever does not have, even what he has will be taken away from. So he's saying that this stuff is all a stewardship, right? And that if you value it, treasure it, and go after it, God says, I'll give you more and more and more. But if you don't value it, make fun of it, shut it down, don't want to know about it, he said, you'll lose it all. Okay? And so how can you walk in more revelation, more understanding of God's word? Just value it. Just go after it, right? Yeah, absolutely. It's a treasure. And it's bringing the kingdom, because the kingdom comes through the word, the preaching, teaching of the word, and the revelation of the word. It's an amazing thing. Everything in here is a seed to be planted and to grow. Let's see, then there's another parable. Verse 26 goes on, and he said, the kingdom of God. Oh yeah, what are the parables about? Kingdom of God is as if a man should scatter seed on the ground. There's our symbol again. And should sleep by night and rise by day, and the seed will sprout and grow. He himself does not know how. For the earth yields crops by itself, first the blade, then the head, after that the full grain in the head. And when the grain ripens, immediately he puts in the sickle, because the harvest has come. First coming, second coming, how does the kingdom come? The word. Sowing the word. Then what happens? It grows. Why? Because it has life in itself. The word of God will reproduce in you and then through you. Amen. And you become like that mustard tree, right, that begins to, yeah, minister to people all around you. Your influence grows like the leaven in the meal. Your influence grows. The kingdom of God is growing and expanding. And then Jesus comes back and there's a harvest. Wow. He's introducing principles of the kingdom that they need to understand, and they had no idea about when he began to teach them this stuff. It is easier on our end if we're at the end of the 2,000-year period, isn't it? It's a lot easier to look back and go, oh, yeah, I see that. Okay. I'll give you two more passages, and then we'll close for today. Matthew 13, verse 44. And 45 and 46, I think. All right. So one of the principles was that first coming, second coming principle that Jesus wanted them to see. The other one was that the kingdom of God is all about, it's about introducing the kingdom into the earth through the word and then producing a harvest. Okay, we get that. Now there's something else that Jesus wants to teach them about the kingdom. And this parable is really about, it's about the value of the kingdom. It's about the value. And this parable, by the way, goes two ways, and I'll explain. So Jesus said, again, the kingdom of heaven is like treasure hidden in a field, which a man found and hid. And for joy over it, he goes and sells all that he has and buys that field. Okay, let's read 44, 45, 46 also, and then go back. Again, the kingdom of heaven is like a merchant seeking beautiful pearls. And when he had found one pearl of great price, he went and sold all that he had, and he bought it. Cool. Go back to 44, please. So what's he saying? The key word here, the kingdom of heaven is like a what? Treasure. There's your key word. That's what he's telling you. This thing is valuable. This thing is precious. And some people, when they come across the kingdom of God and it's offered to them, they think, that's dumb. I don't want that. That has no value, right? that's not interesting to me at all, and you just lost everything. But if you're offered the kingdom of God and the gospel and Christ, right, and eternal life and this relationship, the whole thing, if you're offered this and you say, wow, this is a treasure, this has value, right, now you're going to get it. And he says that for joy, he goes and sells all that he has and he buys that field. Now, we know that we can't buy the gospel, can we? We can't buy eternal life. We can't buy anything. But remember, Jesus talked a lot about being a disciple. What does being a disciple cost you? Everything. Everything. Salvation costs you nothing. Yeah. Discipleship costs you everything. And he's calling people to be disciples, right? And he says, go and sell all you have to buy that field. And now that could look different for different people. One person might have lands and homes and possessions, and another person might have everything they own in a shopping cart that they stole from Safeway. So what if you sell all you own and it's not enough to buy that field? But in the parable, it doesn't matter how much you have or how much you don't have. The point is, you're trading what you have in this world for that kingdom, for that world. Right? Yeah, anything I have here, I lay it down, little or much, I lay it down for that kingdom, for that treasure, and I get the kingdom of God. Now, this parable also works the other way, too. And Jim and I were talking about it last night. You believe this is the main meaning of this one, yeah. But I see it working both ways. But here's the other way of this. What if this parable is from God's perspective, and it is also, and what if you're the treasure? And you are. Amen. Because there's a treasure hidden in a field. What's the field? It's the world here, and all the mess, and all the brokenness, and everything here. And God sees you, and you're his treasure. And what did God pay to have you? Everything. Everything. Yeah. The one thing that God wanted and needed and did not have was you in your heart, to be with him and love him. And so he paid all that he had to buy you. And I fully believe personally that this parable goes both ways. But I see the value in him. He sees the value in us. And we have an agreement about that. Right? And that's how you have a good relationship. I value you. You value me. When we have that going on, you have an amazing relationship. Amen? So now jump to, and then also I'll give you one more verse. Where was it? Luke 12, 31, 32. And we'll close it here. So Jesus also said, seek the kingdom of God, and all these things shall be added to you. Now, most of you know this verse, and ordinarily when we quote it or teach on it, we take it from from Matthew, right? Matthew chapter 6. But in Matthew chapter 6, he says, seek first the kingdom of God and his what? Righteousness, right? And all these things will be added to you. And in that passage, seek first the kingdom of God. Again, what is Jesus talking about, teaching about? The kingdom. And seek the kingdom, understand the kingdom, right? Participate in the kingdom. And then he also said in the Matthew version, and his righteousness, right? And for a long time, I know I've shared this with some of you, for a long time I would read that verse and I would feel very pressured. Seek first the kingdom of God and his righteousness. And I would think, I have to try really, 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 really much harder to be righteous, right? And then, you know, the one time, you know what I'm talking about? Have you done that? Okay. And then one time the Holy Spirit said, he does this to me once in a while, you don't know what you're talking about. You know, it's like, he whispered to me, whose righteousness? I went, oh, your righteousness, not mine. Oh, thank you. Thank you. How does his righteousness come? It's a gift. It's a gift from him. He clothes us in his robes of righteousness as a gift, and we receive it. Oh, thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. Seek first the kingdom and his righteousness, and then what happens? All these things. And he was talking in the context about, you don't have to spend your life seeking after, you know, how to make a living, how to do that. Don't go out and quit your job right now. But the point is, right, it's not all about getting food on the table. It's not all about getting clothes and paying the rent. Paying the payment. That's not what life is all about, right? He says, seek first the kingdom and his righteousness. These things will be added to you. God will take care of you, right? But don't go quit your job. And unless he tells you to. Then verse 32, he says, what? Do not fear, little flock. Now this is amazing. This is precious. This is so, so wonderful. Jesus said, do not fear, little flock. Isn't that comforting? He didn't say, be afraid. Pay attention. You're going to mess us up if you're not. He said, don't fear, little flock. It is your Father's, what? Good pleasure to give you the kingdom. Whoa, what? That's a waker upper. We've been talking about the kingdom, right? The kingdom is invading. The kingdom is coming. The kingdom will be within you. The kingdom, there's a king. Choose your loyalties, right? Yes, all that is true. But what Jesus is actually saying here is he's not really calling you to be a subject of the kingdom. He's calling you to be a possessor of the kingdom. Amen. An heir of the kingdom. In other words, he's not. I say it this way once in a while. Did Jesus come so that he could reign and rule over you, or did Jesus come so that he could reign and rule through you? Through you, he wants to reign and rule through you. What is that? You're his body, right? That's what it means. He's the head, we're his body. It says that in the Bible, and he's going to reign and rule through us. He's going to exercise his authority through us as we use his name, as we know his will, as we speak his word, right? And we can cast out demons in the name of Jesus. We can lay hands on the sick. We can preach the word. We can pray. We can prophesy. We can advance the kingdom, right? And in the end, it says we'll reign and rule with him. He's going to reign and rule through us. That was his goal, not to reign and rule over us. Yes, the first thing is we bow our knee. Every knee will bow and every tongue will confess that Jesus is Lord. And that's how you enter the kingdom. But that's the entrance to the kingdom. But then he says, I don't really want to reign over you. I want to reign through you. I want to transform you so that you are in agreement with my heart and we're partners. And I'm reigning through you. Are you in?
Yes.
And so he's saying, I'm not calling you to be a subject of the kingdom. I'm calling you to be a possessor of the kingdom of God. What does the Bible say in Romans 8? We are heirs of God and joint heirs with Jesus Christ. The kingdom is ours and it lives within us, Jesus said. And anywhere we go now, the kingdom goes. And anywhere we go, we can release the kingdom to others, share the kingdom with others, and demonstrate the kingdom. Amen? Oh, hallelujah. Yeah. And remember what it said that the parable about the treasure in the field, he gave all that he had to get this, right? That's what he's saying. Not only did he give the life of Jesus on the cross, not only did he give the Holy Spirit to us permanently and forever, he gave us his kingdom, literally gave us his full kingdom as joint heirs with Christ. Just for one thing, to have our hearts to be his people. To love him. Wow. So let's pray. I didn't even get to half my notes, so we'll continue next week with this. And can we stand together? And if you're at all new with us, we take a few minutes here and we invite the Holy Spirit to come and minister, breathe on us and speak to our hearts. Turn this word into faith. The word becomes faith. So Holy Spirit, welcome right now. We know you've been here like the air, but again, begin to move now like the wind. Holy Spirit, come, begin to touch people and breathe on people. We welcome your manifested presence and your moving and your speaking into our hearts. Holy Spirit, bring the kingdom right now. Bring the revelation of the kingdom to each one of us. Hallelujah. Everyone here who's been born again through faith in Jesus Christ is a prince or a princess of this kingdom, a possessor of the kingdom, an heir of the kingdom, a carrier and a releaser of the kingdom. Whew, hallelujah. Hallelujah. Lord, we pray that our hearts be good ground. Not stony, not hard-hearted, not resentful or bitter or chasing the things of the world, double-minded and divided. God, we pray that our hearts would be single, good ground for you. Soft soil for the seed of the kingdom, for the word of God to be planted in our hearts and grow and produce the kingdom in us. Hallelujah. Just pray that with me. God, make my heart good soil, good ground, soft, tender, responsive, treasuring and cherishing the Word of God. Make my heart good soil, God. Let your kingdom grow in me. Reproduce the kingdom and become a great tree of ministry and influence through me, God. 30, 60, and 100-fold. I want 100. I want 1,000-fold. I want 1,000,000-fold. God, I want your kingdom to reproduce big in me, God. Here's my heart. Oh, hallelujah. Hallelujah. Jesus, Jesus, Jesus. And I pray, Holy Spirit, right now, as we're just waiting in your presence for another few moments, just let all of this become faith in people's hearts. Let this become revelation and faith in our hearts. Everybody in this room know that they are a possessor of the kingdom, a carrier of the kingdom, a releaser of the kingdom. Hallelujah. Just one more moment. Can we just for a moment again, just lift our hands and say, Holy Spirit, fill me, a fresh anointing, your presence like the wind, like the moving air. Holy Spirit, anoint me, a fresh anointing, a fresh wind. Breathe into me, God, today. Fill me, Holy Spirit. I make room in my heart. It's one of the things the Lord impressed on me last night. Sometimes we ask God to fill us, but we don't give him room. I'm full of anxiety or worry, or I'm mad at somebody or mad about something, and it occupies space in my heart, in my soul. And God says, surrender it. Give me that space. Give me more space. God's given us all of himself, but we need to give him the place in ourselves for him to occupy. So God, we give you worry. We give you anxiety. We give you bitterness or anger or anything, God, that's preoccupying us, anything that we're, the bone that we're chewing on, God, some little bone that we're chewing on and won't let go of, God, we surrender it and we let go. We let go. Take it away, God. We surrender, God, and I give you place in my heart and soul. Come, Holy Spirit, and fill me right now with your presence, your presence, your presence, your love, your faith, your kingdom. Fill me. Breathe into me, Holy Spirit. In Jesus' name. Amen. That's good. That's good. God bless y'all. I love you.